Good morning, students. In the previous video, we had completed our first part, that is autotrophic nutrition in plants. So now, moving on to the next, we have the second part, that is heterotrophic nutrition in plants. So first of all, what is heterotrophic nutrition? In the previous video also, we had done the definition for that, that the nutrition in which organisms can't make their own food and depends on other organisms, like heterotrophic organisms, yeah, heterotrophs depends on the plants, we can say they are producers. So the organisms depend directly or indirectly on the autotrophs. So what are heterotrophs? The organisms which can't make their own food, the organisms are called heterotrophs. Examples we have: non-green plants, animals, fungi, bacteria. So these are the examples for the heterotrophs. It is written non-green plants, means they are non-photosynthetic. They can't make their own food, but still they have the characteristics of the plants. So we have four different types of heterotrophic plants. They are parasitic plants, insectivorous plants, saprotrophic plants, and symbiotic plants. So these are the four types of heterotrophic plants. So one by one we'll discuss about these plants. So first of all, parasitic plants. What are parasites? The plants which live in or on the body of other organism and derive food or shelter or both by harming them. Surely you have to write harming them, because parasites harms the other organisms on which it lives. The parasites which lives on the plants on which the parasites lives, they are called host, but actually they are not guests, you can see, because they harming them. They are not guests, they are called parasites. So parasites are of two types: complete parasites and partial parasites. Complete parasites, these organisms, these parasites completely dependent on the host organism, we can say. So what are they? The non-green plants which live in or on the body of other organism and derive food and shelter, both the same things, and also they harm them. Again, I am telling you, we have to write harming them. Surely you have to write. Okay. So the non-green plants which lives in or on the body of other organism, okay, that is called complete parasites. They completely dependent on the host. For example, we have dodder or cuscuta, we can say. The second one is partial parasites. These are the green colored parasites. Okay. As they are green, they can make their food. But why they are called partial parasite? Because they lives on the host for taking water and minerals. What it means? They can make their food, but the requirement of the water and minerals are fulfilled by the host organism. The example for that is mistletoe. So one by one we'll see. Here you can see the complete parasite, that is dodder or cuscuta. You can see the organism is living on the host plant, the green colored plant, you can see, and it is entangled on, the parasite is entangled on that. Okay, so this is the complete parasite, dodder. One more image we can say, but it is not clear in this image that how they are harming them. In this diagram you can see that this is the dodder which is spread on the plant. So what harm it causes to the plant? It prevents the sunlight that falls on the host plant. It means the plant is not able to make its food because of this dodder. So this is the harm to the plant. Okay, so this another example. This is the example for the partial parasite. The ball like structure you can see on this tree, you can see this is green, so it means it can make its own food, okay. But for the water and minerals, it depends on this plant, this tree, sorry, this tree. So this is the example of the partial parasite. As we have already discussed, that parasites are of two kinds, complete parasite and partial parasites. Okay. So now moving on to the second one, we have the insectivorous plants. As the name suggests, the plants which consumes insects and digest them, they are called insectivorous plants. Means they consumes the insects and digest them. Okay. So the examples for that is Venus flytrap and the pitcher plant. So what they are doing, first of all, where they grow. The insectivorous plants grows in the places where soil lack nutrients. Okay. Every organism needs nutrient, but these kinds of plants grows in the area where nutrients are absent. So to fulfill their requirement of nutrients like nitrogen, they kills the insects. They can make their food, but nutrients are due to unavailability of the nutrients, they depends on the insects and kills them. So how they are killing the insects, they trap and kill insects to fulfill their nutrients requirements, we can say. So how the complete process we will do one by one, but by taking the examples of both of this one by one, that is Venus flytrap and the pitcher plant. So this is the example, that is pitcher plant. In Hindi we can say what is the meaning of pitcher, that is surahi, we can say surahi is the meaning of pitcher. You can see the pitcher like structure is present in this. So in this pitcher, you can see in this pitcher hairs are present downward, the direction of the hairs are downward. Okay. And whenever there are some juices which are present inside this pitcher, and you can see the lid upside, this is the lid which is present upside. Okay. So what happens whenever the insects come in the this pitcher and attracted by this pitcher, what happens? Suddenly the lid get closed and the nutrients are completely the inside of this pitcher, juices are released which helps in converting that insect into the simple material or nutrient, and then these are absorbed by this plant. So by this method it is fulfilled, the requirement is fulfilled. Then the next example we have Venus flytrap. Okay. This is again we have the another example for the insectivorous plant. So in the insect also you can see. So what happens whenever the insects come in contact in this trap, okay, it get closed and then it is converted into the simple one, and the requirement of the nitrogen specially is fulfilled. Okay. Now third one, we have the saprotrophic plants. The plants which get their food supply from dead and decaying plant and animal matter, or the plants which get their food supply from dead and decaying plant and animal matter, that is called saprotrophic plants. Examples for the saprotrophic plants are Indian pipe and coral roots. These are some of the examples. Some points about the saprotrophic plants are, some plants bear flowers also. In the example of the Indian pipe, the white colored structure you can see, these are flowers on that. These plants grow in the shady areas. Okay. Fungi in the roots of these saprotrophic plants, fungi is present, fungi which secrete some juices, digestive juices, which convert the organic matter. Organic matter means the matter which is dead, and the matter which is of plant and animal, they feeds on that. Who feeds on that? The fungi. And fungi is present in the roots of this saprotrophic plants. Okay. This solution then used by the saprotrophic plants as nutrients. Okay. So Here we have the example of the Indian pipe. You can see it grows in the shady areas on the organic matter. This is the plant matter. Actually, they looks very beautiful, you can see, but they are saprotrophic plants. This is the another example, coral roots. Okay, here you can also see they are growing on the shady areas and on the dead and decaying organic matter. One point to remember, fungi are earlier considered as saprophytic plants. Fungi are earlier considered as saprophytic plants, but actually fungi are not plants. Okay, fungi are the saprotrophic organism, but we can't say that fungi are plants. So what is the reason behind that? Why it is considered as saprophytic plant earlier? This is the reason. In the ancient time, or previously we can say, the whole living world is divided into two parts, that is classified into two, that is plants and animals. So fungi are placed in the category of the plants. Okay, but because it have the characteristics of the plants, some characteristics of the plants we can say. So the whole living world is classified into two parts, that is plants and animals. So but it is modified, and after that the whole living world, or we can say the living organisms, are divided into classified into five kingdoms, we can say. First kingdom, very least developed organisms, they falls in the category of bacteria. Then we have also another very simple organisms, that is amoeba. Okay, and the third one, that is fungi. It is, you can see, it is separated from the plants, which is earlier included in the plants. So then we have the plants, then we have the most developed organisms, that are animals. Okay, so that's why we can say fungi are saprophytic organisms, not plants. Okay, so this is the point to remember about the saprotrophic organisms or saprotrophic plants. Now we have the fourth kind of heterotrophic plant, that is symbiotic plants. Okay, they are somehow resembles the parasitic plants, but that already I told you, in the parasitic plants they harm the plant on which they live. Okay, so what about the symbiotic plants? Plants that live in mutual relationship with other organism, such that both share nutrients and other resources. It means both the organisms live together and share their nutrients. It means one makes the nutrient and other give shelter to the first organism. It means first organisms provide the nutrient and the second organisms provide the shelter to the first. So for that we have the example of lichen. So what is lichen? Symbiotic association between algae and fungi. In this association, algae and fungi both live together and share their things. What are the things they are sharing? Both live together. Algae is photosynthetic. It means algae makes the food and share with fungi. In turn, fungi provide water, minerals, and also the shelter. Shelter means in the place of living. Fungi provide these things, water, minerals, and shelter, to the algae, and algae provide the food to the fungi. So you can see they are mutually benefited, not harmed. Okay, again I'm telling you, if difference will come, okay, between the parasites and the symbionts, you can say, you can write that in parasitic plants the host is harmed, but in this they are mutually benefited. Okay, so example, this is in this diagram you can see the lichen. Then one very important example of the leguminous, that symbiotic association, we have the leguminous plants and the bacteria rhizobium. So in the diagram you can see picture, some of the examples of the leguminous plants like common bean, pea, lentil, chickpea, mung bean, broad bean. These are the examples for the leguminous plants. So, they make the symbiotic association with the rhizobium bacteria. Okay, as already we had discussed that symbiotic association, both the organisms are mutually benefited. So, rhizobiums lives in the root nodules of the leguminous plants. Okay, they live in the roots of the leguminous plants. And what they provide? We know that every organism, every plant especially, needs nitrogen to make their food material for the growth and development. But the plants can't get the nitrogen directly from the atmosphere. So, the rhizobium bacteria, what they are doing, they are taking the atmospheric nitrogen and they convert that into the usable form and they gives to the leguminous plant from the roots. And what they are taking, rhizobium bacteria, they are taking the shelter. They are living in the roots of that. It means they are taking the shelter. So you can see both the organisms get mutually benefited. So this is all about the symbiotic plants. Or in the diagram also you can see these are the root nodules and some of the bacteria you can see, the white colored bacteria. These are the bacteria you can see. Okay, so they lives in the root nodules of the leguminous plants. So students, we had completed our this topic, heterotrophic plants and heterotrophic nutrition. So our first chapter is completed. Watch the video again and again. Okay, and do the assignments properly. Thank you students, thank you and have a nice day.